introducing. Thank you, amigo. That's fantastic. I like that vision. The place swelled full of people to we can't fit any more in. And also, we also continue our work from here throughout the year. And so one thing I'd like to mention to you is a particular focus that was represented today in the pre-conferences. The pre-conferences today were bringing together our community, really rolling up our sleeves and looking at how to work in particular areas. So the Occidental Arts and Ecology Center sponsored a permaculture and production agriculture pre-conference where people had site maps and were working on things. The meat producers from the Central Coast were gathered with advisors to discover how to create co-ops that will help them overcome bottlenecks so that they can be successful in bringing the kind of quality and healthful meat to the marketplace in their local communities. And the seed growers were taking up the issue of how do we create an ethic and a community that can support public domain open pollinate seeds that can continue to expand the viability of open pollinate and healthful varieties that can be accessible to all, carrying on the tradition that we're entrusted with as farmers with the seeds that have been handed down to us for generations. And what will the seeds look like that we're going to hand down to future generations? So I applaud all of the efforts today and everyone who participated in that. And these themes will continue throughout the conference. So without any further ado, I would like to draw your attention to the fact that Bill McKibben will be present with us by video. Bill McKibben is an author and environmentalist. His 1989 book, The End of Nature, is regarded as the first book for a general audience about climate change and has appeared in 24 languages. He is founder of 350.org, the first planet-wide grassroots climate change movement. The Schumann Distinguished Scholar in Environmental Studies at Middlebury College and a fellow of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, he was the 2013 winner of the Gandhi Prize and the Thomas Merton Prize, and holds honorary degrees from 18 colleges and universities. Foreign Policy named him on their inaugural list of the world's most 100 important global thinkers. And the Boston Globe said he was probably America's most important environmentalist. A former staff writer for The New Yorker, who frequently writes on a wide variety of publications around the world, including the New York Review of Books, National Geographic, and Rolling Stone. He lives in the mountains above Lake Champlain with his wife and writer Sue Halperin. The video that you're going to see was created specifically for our audience in the midst of Bill's very busy schedule. I think you'll note as he delivers his message quite how busy he is as the phone rings while he's delivering his message to us. So we thank him for putting it together, and we trust that his message will come through loud and clear.
Well, hello everybody. Now I wish I was there at Asilomar with you. That's about as beautiful a place as there is in the whole world, with the Pacific pounding in around you. And I gather that following me some point today, my old friend Gary Nabhan is going to pound on you as well. And I hope that's true, because he's a very he's a very effective motivator, and God knows we need some. The work that you guys are up to is absolutely critical, as you know. So let me just provide from a distance just a little bit of kind of ground, as it were, from which to work. You know that I wrote the first book about climate change. It came out now more than a quarter century ago in 1989, and then we knew basically the outline of the problem. We knew that when we burn fossil fuel, we put a lot of carbon into the atmosphere, and that that accumulation of carbon in the atmosphere was raising the temperature. We didn't know how fast it was going to happen. We didn't know what chaos it was going to cause. A quarter century on, change is coming much more quickly than we had thought. And one of the best places, of course, to see that is in its effect on people trying to grow things out of the ground. As the century wears on, we're clearly going to get to the place where we take the planet's temperature on current trajectories outside the range at which our major crops thrive. And the work from Stanford and University of Washington and elsewhere makes it clear that that's going to be an enormous problem, that from this point on, each degree increase in global average temperature should cut grain yields about 10%, which is about as bad news as one could ask for. Even before that happens, or even as that's starting to happen, we're already also seeing the effects of what happens as you change the hydrological cycle, the way that water moves around the planet. Warm air, as you know, holds more water vapor than cold. That means we get more evaporation, and hence in arid areas, it means that we get more drought. California has all too much experience of that drought going on at the moment. We hope very much that your conference is interrupted by torrential downpour. I know that the rains of December gave people at least a teasing hope that the drought might be breaking, but the basic news is that one expects California to be in mega drought probably for a long time to come. There was a particularly disheartening story today about the fact that California has lost about half of its big trees since the 40s, and that the biggest reason for that is water stress caused by climate change. Drought is half the equation. Once that water is up in the atmosphere, it doesn't stay long. The average residence time for a molecule of water vapor in the atmosphere is only about 7 days. It's going to come down, and increasingly it comes down in gully washers, in the kind of rain that does nobody any good, least of all farmers. Today we're thinking very much of our 350.org colleagues in Africa. Malawi, Mozambique, Madagascar have been suffering record rains, and as a result, record floods, and as a result, an enormous number of people suddenly without food because the maize crop won't be grown this year. So that's the situation we're in. We've got to very quickly put a halt to climate change. We've raised the temperature 1 degree, but we're on a path to raise it 4 or 5 degrees Celsius this century. That'll make life impossible, so our job is to stop it short. There are two major ways of doing that, and both of them are important. One of them, maybe the most critical, the emergency, the thing that I spend most of my time on, is figuring out how to stop pouring as much carbon into the atmosphere. That means breaking the power of the fossil fuel industry to dominate our political life. That means standing up on issues like the Keystone Pipeline or all the other places where we're kind of fighting to prevent the expansion of the fossil fuel industry. It means working hard on the divestment campaign that's now really sort of sweeping around the world, that challenges their ability to keep raising the financing to expand their operations. It means taking it to these guys at every opportunity, and that's beginning to work. The news that came in September that the Rockefeller family, the original fossil fuel fortune, had decided to divest their holdings in coal and gas and oil because it was both financially unwise and immoral was maybe one of those moments that'll mark a kind of turning point. It came on the evening of the great climate march in New York with 400,000 people pouring through the canyons of Manhattan to demand change. This is a bitter fight that needs your help. The second half of the equation is that we've got to take carbon out of the atmosphere. Forests and oceans do some of that for us. Soils can do a lot of it too, especially if they're managed much differently than they are at the moment. And I'm very glad that you guys are addressing this. The ability to sequester some carbon from soil is good news. And good news in part because, as with the transition to renewable energy, the world that you create when you begin taking soil seriously is a better world than the one we live in, even irregardless of climate change. taking soil seriously means taking farming seriously. It means getting over our idea that it's wonderful that we've reduced the number of farmers in America to 1% of our population. We're a country that has more prisoners than farmers, and that's a pretty dubious distinction. It means not that we're going to go back to half of America farming the way we were 100 years ago. That's not going to happen, but we're going to need a lot more brains and judgment and muscle on the farm. And as we do, we'll build stronger, more democratic, more resilient and prouder societies than the ones we have at the moment, just in the same way that we will as we replace a few centralized forms of energy with sun and wind and things that we have available locally that don't beggar us in order to run our lives. That these things are now possible is the most encouraging sign in the world. 25 years ago, we still talked about solar power with our fingers crossed. 25 years ago, the number of farmers in America was still declining. It was only Wendell Berry and a few of the rest of you visionaries who were really thinking about the way that agriculture might rebound on a local and sustainable scale. But those things are so real now. We have more than the seeds. We have more than the first green shoots. We have pretty healthy seedlings now of a new world that we can transplant in place after place after place. And I am so grateful that you are about that work. We need you doing it every day because you're the specialists and the experts in it. And then we need you a few times a year pitching in with this larger fight against the fossil fuel industry, who are the biggest enemies that the human race has known in this time. And we need you helping us take them on. I'm awfully grateful for all you do, and I wish I was there in beautiful Monterey. Say hi to the say hi to the waves for me, and say hi too to the to those monarchs up in their trees in Pacific Grove. A good symbol, as I think Gary may tell you too, of why we have to make this world a little different. A world that can't sustain the great migration of the monarchs off this continent south. That's a much sadder and more impoverished world, and you guys play a big part in that as well. Thank you all so much.
We thank Bill for his message. And also to pick up on it, I'm wondering if people are becoming aware of Dr. Ratan Lal, the Ohio State soil scientist, who speaks to the important role that the work that we're doing can play in reversing climate change. Now, it is no mere feat, but 2% increase of organic matter in the agricultural soils in the world, according to Dr. Lal's model, would reverse climate change. It would eliminate the crisis that we're in. So, that's right, yeah. sometimes the obvious is so obvious. Tonight's talk, now to be picked up by Gary and Brock, will pick up on the theme that the solution is really under our feet and the work that we do. I'd like to take this moment to welcome Gary Paul Nabhan. He's an internationally celebrated nature writer, food and farming activist, and a proponent of conserving the links between biodiversity and cultural diversity. He has been the W.K. Kellogg Endowed Chair in Sustainable Food Systems at the University of Arizona, as well as a permaculture designer and orchard keeper for the Alumnia de los Zopilotes Experimental Farm in Patagonia, Arizona. He has been honored as a pioneer and a creative force in the local food movement and seed-saving community by Utne Reader, Mother Earth News, The New York Times, Bioneers, and Time Magazine. He's also a recipient of a MacArthur Genius Award, and his 24 books have been translated into 6 languages. Gary, some years ago, was on my list of people to reach out to from the EcoFarm office, and one story that I have is back in the days when you left messages on message machines, his message machine said, hello, this is Gary. I'm out in the field doing field work, and I'll be back in touch with you in a few months. Thankfully, he did that field work. I'm sure some of you have enjoyed some of his writings about that. And he's continued to do this work and to hold a vision through his research. And I'd like to ask you to join me in welcoming him for his speech tonight.
That was good. Greetings, Earthlings. Really glad to be here. I just think the collective work that you do is some of the most important on this little planet. I'm going to be talking to you, thanks to Ken and Lauren, they asked me to do something that I've never done here before. I think I've talked as a science geek, as a pollinator, as a seed saver, and even as did something called the Mezcal Monoculture Blues one time. So I was doing a tequila 12-step program for y'all. I forget what it was. This year I'm talking as a practitioner. I have to talk from someone who's growing food on my own, with my community, with a whole bunch of collaborators, and it's a great challenge to do that among people who are doing it every day. The only thing I didn't like about coming here today is that it said that my name tag down on my chair said reserved Gary Nabhan. And I don't think any of us come here to be reserved. So I want to see your energy, not only tonight, but through the whole thing, because we do have a lot of work to do, as Bill said. Good, good, good.
Sounding kind of funny.
Okay. I have to say, for Bill McKibben's sake, too, that car is not run on fossil fuels in that picture. It's run on chili gas. So don't worry, Bill, wherever you are. So I'd like to take you south from here into the desert, because I think we have something to learn, humbly learn, from a 4,100-year legacy of agriculture in North America that began in arid lands. Some of the hottest, driest places on this continent was where we had the first agriculture here. And I think the elders of agriculture, and I don't mean just Amigo Bob, I mean the elders that are 4,100 years in duration here on this continent, have something to teach us all, because they've been dealing with drought, heat waves, and water scarcity for millennia. And because American farming began in Arizona and some of the driest places, I think that gives us pause. But even when we go back to the oldest agriculture in the Americas, the picture with those cliffs is from Gila Nakit's cave in Oaxaca. It's really an arid thorn scrub. And like where my wife Lori and I live, near the Mexican border, it's in the 8 to 18 inch rainfall range most year. It's a rain shadow valley, and that's where people really began to cultivate food, not just to forage the many diverse wild plants. And so there's something that we can learn from how they met the challenges that many of us are now facing where we live. And I'm going to really bypass the problems. I think Bill laid out what we're facing very deeply. That little word poem that the arrow is pointing to is all the many different ways that we can look at the challenges facing us today. But I think what we're about here and what you're about in the places that you live is how we can craft large-scale, lasting solutions. And the good news is what Paul Kaiser, one of my heroes who's here in the audience tonight, has reminded me that there's almost a dozen studies now that say the same thing, that more than any other human economic activity, small and mid-scale farming and more localized food distribution have this enormous capacity to reduce greenhouse gas emissions, to sequester carbon, and become climate solutions rather than farmers being seen as part of the problem. And that's what we're really here about. The way that many of you have already been farming is part of the solution. And I don't want to rule out large-scale agriculture here, but compared to that little car I showed you, large-scale agriculture is like the big cruise ship to try to get it to turn around towards a more carbon-friendly trajectory. It's going to take longer, and you all are the scale that can mobilize solutions. You're really the incubator for all scales of agriculture in what you do and how it can reduce carbon emissions, deal with the water scarcity that we're facing already, and combine a mix of strategies for a more climate-friendly food production system. So I want to say that in trying to bring you down to the what I call the snoring desert with me on the Arizona-Mexico border, I'm not doing that because it's about me or us. I have a lot of pride in the community where I live, Patagonia, Arizona. Paul was with us when we declared it the pollinator capital of the world. In my overzeal, I tried to have us declare it the pollinator capital of the universe, but some people pulled me back in. But I really want to talk about not what I'm doing or even the community of farmers is doing, but what that place can teach us about endurance. I think that's what we're talking about now. Many of you have weathered a series of economic challenges the last 10 years with the Great Recession or whatever we want to call it. You've now faced one of the toughest droughts that the North American continent has ever seen. And how do we not only endure that, but come around so that we're learning something from it, albeit with some scar tissue, that can help us carry forward and help us be mentors to new farmers who may have to face the kind of conditions that Bill was just talking about. And I'm grateful forever, indebted forever, to the many Hispanic and indigenous farmers who allowed me to work with them in the field, on my hands and knees, behind draft animals from the mid-1970s on, in seeing how they farmed to deal with drought and water scarcity and the heat of the desert. And so nothing I'm here saying is really my own innovations as much as what I've gleaned from working with who I consider the real masters of climate-friendly agriculture. So many of you may not know that south of Phoenix, Arizona, we've succeeded from the rest of Arizona, which we now call the dry hate state, and we're calling ourselves Baja Arizona. We have the largest edible magazine in the country, 200 pages every 2 months, 220 farms and restaurants and food carts and other food businesses featured in putting out 1,200 to 1,400 pages of innovations that are happening with desert agriculture each year. And why I want to bring you down to Arizona and Baja, Arizona in particular, is that we've already been facing for decades some of the conditions. Obviously in Southern California, there are similar conditions and have been for a long time. But there are conditions that many of you are now facing in terms of really, really tough water scarcity that may or may not go away. It may be alleviated in a matter of degrees, but it's something that we have to live with overall. And what I want to remind you is that California and Arizona and New Mexico and Texas are really in this together. We have to learn from each other. We need that cross-pollination between what you're doing here and what innovators are doing down in Arizona and New Mexico, and as I said, learning also from the people who went before us who had to learn these hard lessons or they wouldn't have survived. So, oops, let me go back one. There we go. So this Almunia de los Zopilotes that Ken mentioned means the vulture's experimental orchard. Almunia is an old Arab word that came into Spanish and then spread into Mexico and Latin America. As a private experimental orchard garden where you evaluate different techniques and different seeds and fruit trees, and whatever works you pass on to your neighbors, whatever doesn't work you feed to the vultures. And what I'd like to say is that I think there's a brilliant democratic theme under that, and that's that up until about 150 years ago, what we call experimental farms, teaching farms, demonstration farms, were what the best of you would offer to your community. You were the ones who distributed selected genetic resources that were adapted to your place. You did the plant breeding, not an experiment station in Davis or Corvallis or Ames, Iowa. You all evaluated that material. Many of you are doing that now. The difference between farmer bred and heirloom vegetables and fruits is a matter of a half a degree. And I think we need to return to that and not expect the state agricultural experiment stations and the USDA agricultural experiment stations to do the work for us. We have to get back to that fact that the innovation is going to come from the margins and the edges of our society and the farming community, and if it's good, it will be mainstream. And so we're nested, we're sort of nested sets. Lori and I live on about 5 acres that now I'm putting into an orchard for nursery propagation of the best low-chill, desert-adapted varieties that friends and I have collected in Baja California, southern New Mexico, southern Arizona, Sonora, Mexico. And we're evaluating those low-chill, heat-adapted varieties, but we're also looking at the soil and water techniques that are matched with them. We're above this 60-acre native seed search farm that I helped start 30 years ago so that when I die, they can just roll me downhill and compost me. But we're also across the only highway through our parts, right across the road about 500 yards from us. We've just worked with a hybrid nonprofit, for-profit, to set aside 1,250 acres that will be a grass bank for ranchers, a wildlife corridor for jaguars and ocelots, and rural livelihoods, green jobs training center for unemployed Hispanic farm workers and farmers in our county, one of the more poorest counties along the border. So it's nested sets, it's a lot of connectivity, and why I'm mentioning that is climate change is not going to be solved by single farms in isolation. The food shed, the watershed, the culture shed within which we work matters more than ever before. And so we have to be the ones that are reaching out and creating those hyphae like Michael Risey do, the connectivity between different pieces of land in our own landscape to make the whole thing work together. The easy way to say that instead of hyphae of Michael Risey is no farm is an island when it comes to climate change. And so this idea of a food shed and culture shed where people are working together for larger solutions is essential. We can't protect pollinators on a single farm if everyone around us is using Roundup or toxic pesticides. So again, what that means is we have to have strategies to keep the fabric of our communities intact. It's not about single properties, but that entire connection with the watershed and the airshed and the food shed that support us. And that's going to take novel alternative financing structures like crowdfunding, like slow money, like the food commons that Larry's working on, that so many things are needed to allow this infrastructure to thrive and become economically as well as ecologically viable. That's why we're experimenting with limited profit, limited liability, for-profit corporations with social values driving what they do, along with a nonprofit that my wife Lori just helped us incorporate to pair with that. So think about the diversity of financing for what you need to get done, not just the diversity of plants or animals or soil microbes on your place. Our goal in the long run is to restore the diversity of ecological interactions in our foodscape, because that's what will give us resilience in the face of climate change. It's not about one GMO climate-friendly crop. It's about a whole suite of mutually supporting organisms. And those of you that have had permaculture training from Brock or Dave live and breathe that, so I'm not telling you anything new, but the way this chart says it is that we need that soil microbial diversity, the crop diversity, and the pollinator and beneficial insect diversity to move us towards what I call food chain restoration, both on our farm in terms of the food chain for pollinators and soil organisms, but also the food chain restoration that gets your product to the people that need to eat nourishing food the most. And that is what can give us enhanced food security, and that in turn is what can give us resilience in the face of climate change. So we do this work in an odd place. There's something inherently unsustainable with desert cities. Phoenix has been called the most unsustainable city in the universe, I think. I can't get our place called pollinator capital of the universe, but I think we'd pretty much agree that Phoenix is the most unsustainable city in the universe, although Dubai is trying to catch up. But the interesting thing is it's also an experimental ground, because the urban heat island effect, where I have an office at a field station in Tucson, means that it's warming up twice as fast as the surrounding desert. And I'll show you some things later on, but springtime wildflowers are flowering 4 to 7 weeks earlier than they used to because of this rapid rising. And so people who are trying to grow food close to that city, we're 50 miles out from it, really have to work hard to make sure that those things are coming through. And we have some remarkable things going on even with urban agriculture in Phoenix. How many of you know Brad Lancaster, the crazy water harvesting guru of the world? He's now harvesting millions of gallons of water off Tucson streets for food production in the city. He was fined for cutting curbs with a jackhammer at 6 in the morning. And then the city said, for penance, you have to go out and help us do this everywhere else in the city because our water budget is shrinking and we have to come up with something. At the same time, our rural friends like Avalon Gardens, the south of Tucson, are also just on one farm harvesting millions of gallons of water each year now for their food production. So water harvesting used to be this kind of quaint thing that we talked about on a small scale with rain gardens, and now it's really becoming a viable thing in parts of the Southwest. And our main innovation, if you want to say there is one, is matching those water harvesting techniques with desert-adapted crop diversity. And there's so many seed people and so many panels on these issues that I don't have to go into that in depth. But I want to remind you that water harvesting is also nutrient harvesting, particularly where we live, because all the runoff is coming off legume-dominated watersheds where nitrogen-fixing bacteria and the leaf litter are all contributing nutrients and organic matter to the places where all of that is deposited, where I did my dissertation out with the Tohono O'odham, sometimes foot and a half high drifts of this nitrogen-rich detritus would flow into their fields after a single rain, and they never had to use artificial fertilizers or fertilizers that were bought from another place because a single rain could keep their nutrient levels higher than Midwestern cornfields for 5 years without soil amendments. So things like water harvesting and micro dispersion, by that I mean going drilling down beyond drip irrigation, used to be things that only the fringes in the desert would talk about. And now we have a fairly wealthy neighbor, I think you could say that about Howard Buffett, who said in our Edible Baja Arizona magazine this summer, "I don't believe there should be a single acre of flood irrigation for row crops in Arizona." Now, if a dean of agriculture said that in Arizona, he'd be hanged. But someone like Howard Buffett can say it, and he's serious about it. He said, "If we fully adopt more efficient systems, whatever they are, it's realistic for Arizona farmers to cut their water waste in half." And now people are really taking him up on that and showing that that can be done without limiting or dampening yields or profits. Whatever the water source, improving soil moisture holding capacity by composting and other means is now a necessity, not just a fringe benefit. And it's happening at all scales. We're even in discussion with Marin Carbon Project of having an arid lands version of their projects with rangeland composting, because we think it can double the moisture holding capacity and range productivity of semi-arid grasslands, something we deeply need. And the ranchers that we talked to, and John Wick and others came down to southern Arizona to talk to us about doing this large-scale experiment, said, "We don't care about carbon credits. If you give us more resilient with moisture holding capacity in the soil and more stable yields of grass for our ranches, we're on board even if we never get a carbon credit from the government or from carbon exchanges." The other thing that we're doing, because we can get it locally, there's a lot of biochar being used as a byproduct of charcoal production on mesquite where they're thinning mesquite. We're mesquite advocates. My last book ever will be about mesquite. It'll come out next year, but it is sort of the key thing that keeps us all going in the desert. And if you don't know, mesquite is now a commercial food and wood crop being farmed in Arizona. Arizona Mesquite Company is doing it. It's a marketable product, probably in every farmer's market in southern Arizona, mesquite pods that are as good, if not better, than carob pods. But this mesquite charcoal byproduct of biochar we can get from just south of the border, and we're adding it to every hole that we dig for our orchard, the 110 varieties of perennial fruits, nuts, bulb and succulent crops that we have in our little experimental orchard now. And this is that middle picture is from Paul Marocca. He did the other drawings here. And that's using mesquite as an overstory canopy crop for prickly pears, agaves, and other things on terrace slopes. And we're also using apricot trees, quinces, pomegranates to do this in our swales, in our orchard. Our whole orchard is based on water harvesting swales. So we're doing it both with pruning up mesquites to be nurse plants and then using the fruit trees in the same way. But the key thing is that we want to do as much carbon sequestration on our land as possible. And we're using low-chill fruit trees and succulent crops that can do that for us, and then evaluating them for their adaptations to multiple kinds of stress, not just merely drought, but wind, heat, and insect and pest damage that actually, or insect and virus damage that actually increased during drought in our area. Amidst our crop diversity, we also have what I started my checkered career out studying, and that's heat-tolerant short-cycle varieties, little tepary beans that are faster than a speeding bullet that can mature on one or two rainfalls, literally to dry bean seeds in 60 days. And so we plant these only when the summer rains come up. We just have drip emitters during drought on the trees, but then when we get rains between the trees, we plant all these ephemeralized annual crops, the short-cycled ones, and try to bring them through just on rainfall. And we've also done that with winter crops that have a slightly different strategy, but again, we've gone deep into our crop history and brought back white Sonora wheat, something that some of you may be familiar with. Sally Fox and others among you have probably tried it. In Arizona, it's grown. I collected some of the last seed of that 30 years ago, and it was sort of like a curiosity piece until all these fabulous artisanal bakers and microbrewers came along. And it looks like we'll be up to 1,000 acres of white Sonora wheat in Arizona. It's in about 6 microbreweries. So my friends say I've given up the local food movement for the local drink movement. But if it works, I don't care. But these things use about 1/5 of the water that our conventional winter crops use in Arizona. And Hayden Flour Mills, that's Emma Zimmerman, on the harvest where we made Frika from white Sonora wheat 2 springs ago. We're also worried about the sun, damaging radiation that increases our vulnerability to viruses. So there's interactions between pests and diseases and heat and drought, as many of you know. And so we're putting more and more of the greens we grow under shade covers or under nurse plants or in the shade of hedgerows and windbreaks. And so are the Native American farmers over south of Albuquerque who used to grow all their chilies in the sun. Now they grow them in the shade of cottonwood fence rows like the one in this picture. And this whole idea of nurse plants that many of you know from permaculture literature extends into Janine Benyus's ideas of eco-mimicry and ethno-mimicry, biomimicry in general, to design nurse plant guilds for growing foods under arid conditions. And I'm not going to go through this list, but it's not just about giving them a little shade. It's multiple benefits to the understory crops that grow with and complementary to tree crops. So we're trying to do more carbon sequestration, but grow the annuals in the shade of these trees, because even things like chili only need about 60% of the sunlight that they would get under ambient conditions. And I want to say that we're really fine-tuning the idea of nurse plant guilds by watching what naturally happens with mesquite, because certain nurse plants and understory plants have historic traditions, ecological relationships that are really particular to certain combinations. It's not a random assortment. And so we want that shared history and complementarity to guide how we construct these nurse plant guilds. And the classic one, of course, is the saguaro cacti, you know, the guys like this that grow down by us in Tucson. They always have their hands up. I guess they think Sheriff Arpaio is coming to get them. There's a set of cacti that grow under them that share the same mycorrhizae with them, and have, in lacking those mycorrhizae, if we transplant those cacti out into the desert, they immediately die. We could say the same thing by analogy as how we need to select our animal breeds, drawing on old genetic resources from desert regions like the Criollo Coriani cattle or Navajo Churro sheep, which Lori and I raised for 9 years, or a variety of goats. That's Debbie Weinstein of the Young Farmers, Young Agrarians Coalition with her goat herd just to the east of us. But I think really looking for stock that have great heat tolerance, smaller size usually, and our browse animals rather than grazing animals is the way we're going down in our area. We're also inspired by your neighbor and another one of my heroes, John Anderson, for the work he's doing at Hedgerow Farms with hedgerows that can provide multiple benefits, not just insectaries for beneficial insects and crop pollinators, but browse for some of these animals during times of drought. And we're looking at what Sonoran farmers do to manage these hedgerows in an active way for multiple products. And we're using hedgerows to buffer crop pollinators from climate changes because of this 4 to 7 week earlier flowering and shorter periods of flowering of the kind of nectar plants that we want in association with our crops. So if the nectar plants in the spring are drying up and shutting down before our crops come on, we have a gap of 3 to 5 weeks now that we didn't used to have, where there's no nectar sources for pollinators that we later need for trees. So we're doing some crazy things of going from some hedgerows that Sam and Joanne helped us plant a couple years ago, where we had very little flowering in the spring with them, to these crazy spaghetti kind of things that you see, those multicolored lines, where the more mature hedgerows, if we select the shrubs and wildflowers in them right, provide a continuous wave one after another of nectar sources all the way through the time that the crops themselves can take over for the bees. We're planning those not in isolation, but with community events, what we call pot parties, where we take potted plants from our greenhouses and get rid of the pots and put them out in the ground. And my wife, Lori, and some of her friends have started this wonderful thing that we call the Borderlands Earth Care Youth Corps. And we take kids from farming and ranching families and let them be mentored by 8 to 10 different ranchers and farmers in our area over the summer. They move between the farms, learning what those women and men's techniques for managing their lands are like. And I think that's the kind of cultural diversity that I need to see. Every farmer is her or his own kind of iconoclast, and if kids see these different role models, they're going to find one who matches up with their own metabolism. And we really need to ensure that there's a diversity of management strategies and people in our agriculture, not just plants and animals alone. So that's back to the final message about resilience has something to do with that diversity. And now the geeky term for that is biocomplexity. It's what you all do, whether you think you are or not, you're the biocomplexity managers of the world. And I used to think redundancy was a bad word, but having these multiple trajectories in a food web rather than just a single food chain works on our farms and it works in our food distribution systems. So climate challenges to our food security are mounting, and farmers need to lead the innovation because you can make the biggest change in redirecting our economies as models and as practitioners. And the kind of challenges that you all are weathering in California right now are not just here, but other parts of the country. 3/5 of the U.S. Farmlands have been hit by droughts the last 3 years. We're likely to lose 60% of all our federal irrigation supplies, Colorado River, et cetera, over the next couple years. Our dams are at the lowest levels in terms of water volumes ever before. And you know the prices here, water in some irrigation districts have gone from $200 to $2,500 per acre foot in the last 4 years. And some water districts will not give people a drop of reservoir water this year. They're going to have to depend on wells and rainfall alone. And that's in New Mexico, parts of Arizona, and California. We're all in this together. That means that we need to invest in pioneering solutions, being incubators, trying things and admitting our failures and talking about our failures as much as we talk about our successes and making sure that those messages are passed on to the next generation, because that's what's going to get them through it or not. We can't be romantic about this. We have to be pragmatic, and we have to admit when we fail and talk about it. And I think that's a really, really important thing that we don't get from the big ag experiment stations. You know, I have a friend who says, there's four things that a farmer won't talk about: his sex life, his business plan, his failures, and his business plan. But the point is that we all have to admit those failures and learn from them, and that's part of the incubation that we must do. So finally, I want to leave with something that a couple of you have seen, and that's to renew your covenant to work on these issues. And I'd like you to all stand up. This is a participatory calisthenics part of it. I'm going to do a kind of little Pete Seeger thing where I'm going to do a line and you're going to do a line. Remember how Pete Seeger did that? I have it wrapped into my head, but I'm going to say a line and then I want you to repeat it. We as farmers, ranchers, gardeners, cooks and eaters. Wish to reaffirm our sacred vows. To take care of, love, and serve this astonishing diversity of foods and cultures on this earth. Through times of prosperity and times of climate catastrophe. In times of drought and times of feast. To sow the seeds of climate justice and food justice. To glean the fruits of food security. To ferment the brew of food democracy. To savor the flavors of true food sovereignty. Through our own actions and our own eating patterns. So that we may all eat what we have truly sown. We reaffirm our covenant with this earth. To humbly be one more way that seeds themselves. Regenerate into more seeds to nourish all of us. Now go out to love and serve one another. To sow, reap, and feast in peace. God bless you. I love you all.
Thank you to Gary, and thank you to Gary for offering us the challenge in the context of real, pragmatic, and working solutions, and that rousing pledge. Our next speaker to conclude this evening's presentation, I'm proud to say and happy to say, it has been a friend of mine for many years, Brock Dolman. I first met Brock. He was setting up a... Thank you. I first met Brock Dolman at a Bioneers conference where he was setting up a flow-form water fountain. And thankfully, I've been friends ever since. Had the pleasure of living at the Occidental Arts and Ecology Center and having Brock as a friend and a teacher. Brock Dolman has taught permaculture and consulted on regenerative projects, design, and implementation internationally in Costa Rica, Ecuador, the U.S. Virgin Islands, Spain, Brazil, China, Canada, Zimbabwe, Tanzania, Democratic Republic of Congo, Cuba, and widely in the United States. He has been the keynote presenter at numerous conferences and was featured in the award-winning films The 11th Hour by Leonardo DiCaprio, The Call of Life by Species Alliance, and Permaculture, A Quiet Revolution by Vanessa Schultz. In October of 2012, he gave a City 2.0 TED Talk. Brock completed his BA in Ecology and Environmental Studies departments at the University of California, Santa Cruz in 1992, graduating with honors. For over a decade, he has served as an appointed commissioner on the Sonoma County Fish and Wildlife Commission. So Brock has traveled the world helping people do design and has illuminated and elucidated how what thinking like a watershed is with his wonderful poetry, and I ask you to help me welcome Brock to the stage.
Thank you. All right. Woohoo! Hi, everybody. Sound good? We're on? All right. I want to see slides on the screen. Well, how are y'all? Good to see you here. Well, I'm super excited to be here, and I'm honored to have been asked to offer up this plenary. I put this first slide up as a way ultimately to really honor all of you and just get on this wave of gratitude for EcoFarm, Ecological Farming Association, and the 35 years of the legacy of the amazing work you all have been doing, and really want to honor that work. In thinking about this talk, I ended up thinking a lot about history and time and such, and so my actual first EcoFarm was in 1985, so this is my 30th year of attending EcoFarm, and I came and I got inspired, I got recharged, I've learned, I engaged, I honored, and I've even been known to dance, as we will see in a couple nights from now. And I think for me, the EcoFarm community has been a learning community for the last 30 years, and so with so many family and friends out in the audience, it's an honor to be before you in that regard. And it made me end up thinking a lot more about history and such. And so a little bit about how it is that I got here, and this is an image of me as a three-year-old in a rice paddy in Okinawa, Japan, while my dad was on his third tour in Vietnam, and chasing tadpoles. And I've never really given that tadpole hunter thing up. I just figured out how to make a living out of that deal. And as a biophiliac, and this is what I'll stand before you as in full transparency here, the pursuit of life has been the driving narrative. Although in the need to make money throughout high school, horticulture was really where I first started, and that wasn't just mowing lawns, but actually working in an actual nursery and propagation and greenhouses and such. But in the end, for my last couple years in my junior, senior year in high school, I ended up doing all of the running a crew and doing all the landscape maintenance at this nuclear power plant on the Chesapeake Bay there. So everywhere that's green, I mowed those lawns, I weedied those areas. Once a month, we sprayed Roundup around the double razor wire fence. I sprayed 1,000 gallons of Roundup a month for every month for all my junior, senior. So the interesting relationship of coming from a military family with this new background in horticulture there was a fascinating thing to then find myself in Santa Cruz in 1984. So obviously some folks know Rich Merrill out there, I'm obviously giving props there to somebody who was very influential in taking my nuke brain over here and radicalizing me in Santa Cruz in this whole arena at Cabrillo College in the horticulture department. And I'm just so happy Ken Foster's here and Cabrillo is amazing in its own ways, the horticulture department is amazing in its ways, and then the permaculture program there so long. So, and just thinking about lineage in this book, Radical Agriculture, which I really got a big awakening on that. And I went to Camp Joy for the first time in 1985. And Camp Joy folks are in the house here and such. And that was, for me, was a really important piece. And so in that turning of consciousness, and as a 20-something, and I really want to honor all the 20-year-olds and young 20-somethings we have in the audience here. How many youngins we got out there? Show of hands, because, right? Oh, I was there 30 years ago with you. And welcome aboard the EcoFarm community, because it's an amazing community of people that will hold you for as long as you want to stay with it. But in getting radicalized, I had to obviously go down and help the Sandinistas in their revolution in the mid-80s there, because that's what happened to us good Santa Cruzans. And so working on organic farming and gardening and in the revolution while our government was funding the Contras, we were on the border near the Honduran border there, helping with this community reclaim their rightful place on the land. Which meant I ultimately felt like I needed to come back, and so I eventually, and I'm a product of the California Community College program as a junior transfer to UC System on a Pell Grant. And that was an amazing program, and I would love to see more of that program resupported. The idea that Obama's going to possibly put a whole bunch more money into community college, I think, is amazing. It's an incredible feeder system. But to be able to then go on to UC Santa Cruz and do a double major in conservation biology and agroecology and get into agriculture, conservation, biology, land use, with amazing teachers such as Steve Gleesman, who I know is well known in this community, or an amazing mentor as well, this gentleman, Dr. Ken Norris, who's passed away, and Melissa Nelson's in the crowd here. And we were both in field quarter with Ken and others. And so just all of that was me just pondering this talk. And so I thought I would let you suffer through the lineage of what it is and how I get to stand before you today as ultimately someone who really has been grappling with the question when I looked at society and look at industrial agriculture and look at the green revolution that was really green for legal tender and ask the question, are we basically, in essence, antibiotic or probiotic? Are you against life, or are you ultimately, I would support us in recognizing that we should be pro-life? And this is a pro-life movement, as Bill McDonough would say, of all species for all generations for all time, pro-life. And it's really critical. Coming to this form of food production, of community growth, is a pro-life process. This is not about rendering down the single life form that's a hybridized, little corporate-controlled, fossil fuel-addicted, ammonia nitrate, speed addict, little irrigated, fetishized, right? GMO crop. It's not. Right? It's not. So at some point, my awakening really in thinking about life and agriculture and then as a wildlife biologist was that when the hydrologic cycle of a place had been compromised, the carrying capacity for life in that place was accordingly compromised. And to paraphrase on a Jacques Cousteau quote, ultimately, water cycle and the life cycle are the same cycle. No water, no life. And so in thinking about cycles and being really interested in this amazing cycle, this amazing planet that we live on here, and as you well now know, I have this experience with nuke power, and I'm actually completely into nuke power desal. I think it's the way of the future. I want my nuke plant 93 million miles away. I want to turn hydrogen into helium through fusion, and then we're going to run a cycle where we're going to desalinate the ocean, and it's called the water cycle. And it's nuke power desal, and that's what's been running the show for 4 billion years, and that's the one we want. So I'm all up for that. You know, the fun thing about the water cycle, more so than almost any other cycle, is that if you think about it, the total volume of water on planet water is finite, and all we got is all we've had, and it's just gone through solid, liquid, gas, phase state changes for 4 billion years. So the noun of water is finite. But because it's a cycle, the verb of water is infinite. It's inequitably distributed in any one year. You may not get what you got before, but it's an annually renewed verb that's infinite within its noun of the overall volume. And that's a really different way to understand the relationships with cycles. And so to really support, I think, this quote by Luna Leopold, Aldo Leopold's son, one of them, this idea that the health of our waters is the principal measure of how we live on the land is looking for benchmarks and ways to evaluate the efficacy of our settlement in place. And I just, as a one who's got water on the brain and thinks like a watershed, whenever I'm somewhere, I always like to think about the watersheds. And so I was appreciating the Monterey Bay National Marine Sanctuary and all of the associated waters that feed into this totem bay of Monterey Bay, and what an amazing place this bay is, and honoring Monterey Bay. Although, at some point, what we experience is there's this sort of bizarre addiction to the fallacious filtration fetish, where we think we can just run water through a bottle, hammer the watershed because some private multinational corporation is going to give it to us in a plastic bottle at 3,000% more than the markup on your public water system, right? So if you are one of those folks who believe this idea and you're willing to invest in it, I would just wish to support you that you're a tad bit, and I'll let you figure it out. right? Don't be so naive to believe that, in fact, it's about watersheds. And it's about topography. I am a topophiliac. And I love the curvature of landscape from the summit to sea and everything that happens in between. And ultimately, what I'm really interested in is the headwaters when we begin to get at the beginning of systems. And as someone who thinks about the headwaters a lot, I'm really ultimately in this headwaters here. I'm interested in this one, which is really the water in our own head, right? And my job tonight is to mitigate a little bit of cerebral imperviousness so you can infiltrate some of that into the system, because I'm really interested in ecosystem restoration here, right? We will not restore the ecosystem until we have a new storyline for the ecosystem, which is our socio-political, cultural, spiritual opportunity. Are we part of or part from? Is the planet a community or a commodity? And it's us collectively to figure that out. I think, and we heard from everybody tonight, that the EcoFarm community and the stance we've taken has chosen the path of life, has chosen the path of water, has chosen the path of humility versus hubris to compose with life versus impose upon life. But I thank you for that with respect to getting clear. Unfortunately, we got a few folks that could use a little bit of help in the headwaters. And so the World Economic Forum folks here in Davos recently meeting, and they just put out their 10th edition of Global Risk 2015. And apparently there was 900 experts who took part in the survey, Global Risk Perception Survey, and they've determined that water crises are the greatest risk facing the world in 2015. Right? And so it's like, oh, these are the titans of industry, the captains of industry who think this, but I do appreciate this idea that one of their spokespeople, they didn't even realize until recently how much our economy and society relied on hydrologic stability. You're like, really? And y'all think you're running the show here? It's like, I think this to me feels like the World Ecologic Forum right here, and it's a whole new agenda here. So I would like to let them all know, and I think let you all know, and as Gary welcomed you all as earthlings, I'd like to introduce or welcome you all as waterlings, because you are truly a bunch of bipedal sacks of saline solution. And be clear about it, welcome to planet water, because this ain't planet Earth. It's not. It's planet water. 70% of the surface of this living, breathing, Gaianistic orb is planet water. And it's the only place in the known universe, and now we can get hyperbolic and talk about the universe here and not get called out for it. In fact, the beauty of this planet is life is endemic here. It's the only known place in the universe where there's this thing called life. Sure, bring it on if somebody else has got it figured out somewhere else. But until do so, here it is. We're here. We're here. Y'all are here. So why not go here? And if anybody's interested in going off to the moon because you found some frozen water on the dark side of the moon, Dark Side of the Moon is a really great album name by Pink Floyd. It's a dumb place to go basically try to make a moon base on. Why would a biologist go to a lifeless place? So let's stay here. Let's keep this place going. It's really beautiful. It's full of life. Now, the interesting thing about life when I'm thinking about it is that if you look at this periodic chart of elements and you really get down to it, 96% of the tissues of all life forms are basically comprised of four elements, carbon, hydrogen, oxygen, and nitrogen. It's pretty impressive. It's pretty impressive. And then we got the other 4% and we can mix them up. And so when I'm interested inquiring about the idea of sustainability, then I'm really supporting you on tracking that at some level, if you're going to define it, it must be about ultimately our ability to sustain the cycles of life. If your endeavor in place is compromising one of the fundamental cycles upon which life is dependent, it's intrinsically unsustainable. So how does the hydrologic cycle, the carbon cycle, the nitrogen cycle, the procreation of healthy, ethno-culturally rich cycles, the return of salmonid cycles, take your pick. Anybody want to holler out a favorite cycle that you just adore and love for us right now? Okay, that's a good one. You want the other... No, I won't touch that one. Be careful what you wish for with the crowd. Never open up to the audience. This is one of them. So you know a bunch of these, but hydrogen and carbon and oxygen, the NPK. Has anybody been tracking? Phosphorus and potassium don't cycle in the same way. You're into mineral cycles, and we've reached peak phosphorus and peak potassium on this planet. And if you think something's going to shut down big ag, track those trends. In a big way. That game is really on. Nobody wants to talk about that one. And then there's this crazy phenomenon that these photons of sunlight come down and strike these solar panels called leaves, and we turn sunlight into sugar, into soil. That cycle? Are you kidding me? You should all snuggle every photosynthetic being out there. Because if this ain't happening, if sunlight to sugar ain't happening into soil, all bets are off. This is the key piece of the puzzle. How do we take the nuke plant 93 million miles away and make sugar out of it? That's your sugar daddy up there, right? And then you got your mineral mama down here, and plants are basically the dakinis doing the doula between birthing that relationship in here. right? So we've got to figure that out. And so at some point, organic by definition, carbon-based life, right? This is what we're looking for. And so in this idea, and Ken brought some of this up earlier, and the Dr. Lal quotes, at looking at, and U.S. Department of Energy's got their idea here about enhancing natural processes. They could have just said, grow plants, people. Removing CO2 from the atmosphere is thought to be the most cost-effective means of reducing atmospheric levels of CO2. But we got to get that in the soil, right, the first sequestration. And I think Dr. Christine Jones is pretty clear that soil represents the largest carbon sink over which we have control, which is an interesting piece. And improvements in soil carbon levels could be made in our rural areas. And this is where we don't want the carbon going is in the ocean right now. Because if you take CO2 and drop it in the ocean, it turns to carbonic acid. And the oceans are 30% more acidic now than at the beginning of the Industrial Revolution. That is not the place to store carbon. We got to store it in the soil. And organic farming, soil water hoarding capacity, nutrient profiles, all of the life, all of the soil food web. The bang for the buck on the stack functions there is unfathomable. And then 2% is you know, probably more accurate, but Alan Yeoman's, P.A. Yeoman's son, was talking about trying to figure out how if we could increase agricultural land down to a foot depth by 1.6%. Maybe 2%. Okay, we're right, it's 3%. But the idea of increasing soil carbon content in agricultural soils across the planet as a primary positive response and adaptation and mitigation simultaneously, in the face of the fact that if water is the prime measure of how we live on the land and you live on planet water, then how's the planet doing? And we just got the news last week that 2014 is the hottest on record, which is a fascinating reality. And you don't even have to listen to the scientists to tell you this stuff, right? I mean, it's pretty damn evident at some level if you're willing to look. I mean, this is an old slide and I keep using it. I can tell you 2015, it's the naked truth of the matter is there's not even a fossa dentale like they have in Ipanema Beach in Brazil over there. It's just on. And at some point, the planet's running a fever. It's a fossil fuel-induced fever. 1.2 degrees Fahrenheit is where it's looking right now. The idea that in including 2014, 9 of the 10 warmest years in a 135-year period that we have occurred in the 21st century. We're 15 years into that gig. So if anybody's not tracking the trend and is in denial of that, denial's not only a river in Egypt, right? And so those folks ought to get clear at some level that we've exceeded peak away, right? There's peak oil and peak water, the halfway point of a resource, but there's no more away. We don't get to, it doesn't go away anymore. We've exceeded peak away. And the idea that the sky's the limit, well, it is. We've limited out the sky's capacity to hold that CO2 or that methane, that sulfur dioxide, and not cook us. So we're there. We've gotten that one. So we got to craft conditions conducive for convivial carbon cycling. Don't you think? Craft conditions conducive for convivial carbon cycling. What is that going to look like? That's what you all have been doing for quite a long time. It's called organic farming. I like this quote here, just perspective, from Ken Caldera. If you were to compress the entire atmosphere so it's the density of water, it would only be 30 feet deep. So all the stuff we're throwing in the atmosphere is like throwing it into an ocean that's 30 feet deep to get a sense of perspective and scale. The atmosphere of the planet is not our private atmospheric dump here. And then I think this data here, just to riff off of Bill's earlier stuff on any of the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports, have pretty clearly indicated human influence is indisputably detected in the warming of the planet. But the pieces on there that I appreciate or I find thought-provoking and Bill invoked is the changes to the global water cycle. So when you look at ocean changes, global water cycle reductions in snow and ice, global mean sea level rise, and changes in extreme in climate extremes, every one of the primary indicators about how planet water is responding to the fever is it's attempting to change the phase state of water, because the only way you break a fever, if you're sweating and changing liquid to gas, you're trying to break the fever. If someone melts an ice cube on your forehead and it goes solid to liquid, you're attempting to cool down and break the fever. And Planet Gaia has got no other choice but to break this fever than to move the hydrologic cycle. There's no other option. Do the math. It's straight physics on this deal. And so basically, and it says global mean sea level rise. It didn't say global nice sea level rise. Because when the sea level comes up in your hood, it ain't going to be nice. And so if you look at this little slide, I've tried to support people and understand the basic the physics, the thermal forcing, that when, you all know this, when you melt a solid and it goes to a liquid, that process is an endothermic reaction, meaning the Mickey Mouse molecule rejiggers its shape and it takes energy, which means it's a cooling reaction. And then when it goes from a liquid to a vapor, it's a cooling reaction. So the fact that all the glaciers on the planet are going away is a big swamp cooler to try to break the fever. And then when you look at the way the cycling of the water cycle with liquid to vapor is ramping up, it's attempting to make a big swamp cooler. Farmers know you can go the other way, though. The frost protection folks in the vineyards use water, and they put liquid water on, and you get it to freeze because heat is given off. So these physics aren't that complicated, and I think you understand them, but trip out on them at a global scale, because that's what's happening. Global weirding is a little bit weird, but there is a method to the madness with respect to how Guy is trying to run the show here. So I guess, are you a part of the solution or part of the precipitate is kind of that existential opportunity to figure out. And I'm hoping we precipitate a change here. And so I just wanted to basically talk about some solutionaries that, again, I've been inspired in and drill the story down a little bit more close to home. And so for many of you may know this entity, there was the Farallons Institute Rural Center, and that was up in Occidental. And it happens to be the property that we currently reside on at the Occidental Arts and Ecology Center in the Sewing Circle community. But back in the 70s, Michael Stusser, an early Chadwick student there and friend of folks, and the gardens and early biointensive gardens were kicking off in those days. But we just did OAC, celebrated our 20th anniversary, and there's a whole bunch of OAC staff out there. So if anybody's from OAC wants to raise your hand and give a shout out, I just want to honor the community of folks that I get to live and work with, there and there and there and there and all around. I think Dougal and Michelle aren't here tonight, so come to the seed swap tomorrow night, love them up. But it's really a community effort, and I get to be here as a representative, and I'll get a spanking later for all the things I should have said, because there's so many people watching, but that are really watching. At OAC, I think in the last 20 years, and have a look at our new website there, we're really trying to figure out what does it look like to pragmatically model resiliency as we're training change makers in the process of building capacity within communities, ultimately to change rules and that narrative, and that happens at different scales, and it's an amazing, enthralling experiment, and lots of mistakes need to be admitted, that's for darn sure. The Mother Garden there, many of you been up to it, it was CCF certified long before we got there. At this point, I think the factoids are, it's like number 7 in California for CCF certification. It's the first, there's a land easement on our two gardens there that are require in perpetuity as attached to the deed that the gardens have to be certified organic in perpetuity upon any sale in the future, which is the first in the nation when we bought the land 20 years ago. And if anybody's been up there and put your hands in the soil in the North or South Garden, it's just elbow deep, the sweetest, blackest, richest gold you could ever imagine. It's amazing and wonderful soil. And then, I don't know if Olivia's in the house here, but we have this amazing cookbook coming out in March, and we hope you all will buy it. And it's for gatherings large and small, so the recipe's there for 6 or 30. Take your pick. The proportions cross over. So it's a really a wonderful effort, not just of a cookbook, but a whole story, which we're excited about publishing with Chelsea Green. Part of this narrative, I think, and I'm happy that there's so many folks involved in the ecological literacy movement and school garden movement that's really been engaged in EcoFarm for so long, and it's the ecosystem restoration piece of this puzzle and getting at the schools and the K-12 opportunity. And so we've had our school garden teacher training program now almost 20 years, and the resilient schools program is really ramping up, getting much larger, and just the impact on the number of students is amazing, mostly urban, to be honest with you, for the most part, not entirely. Our permaculture design program at this point, we're 20 years in. It's the longest running permaculture center on the West Coast at this point, training folks in there. For those of you who thought permaculture was a hairdo in Alaska, we really see permaculture as a design method for creating regenerative human settlement systems based in natural patterns and processes. And there's a bunch of principles that you can see there that we really think about, but to the degree that in your operation you could use protracted and thoughtful observation that composes with instead of imposing upon and then works from patterns to details to think spatially in 3 dimensions while working in the dimension of time to optimize ecotones that optimize yields using on-site resources, in seeing that the problem lies the solution, where pollution is an unused resource and the least change for greatest effect allows you to stack functions to ensure planned redundancy, to locate elements relationally, but you must remember it depends. Right? And so how does that work as a pragmatic piece? And some folks were at the workshop today. We got anybody who was at the workshop today? Was that fun? You guys had fun at that? It seemed fun to me to look out at the table. There's like 30 or 40 designs and people drawing on them and talking about permaculture as a design methodology. Permaculture is a global movement of like-minded people and have taught in Brazil. Crazy. Imagine a course, four languages simultaneously with people from 55 countries in the favelas of Sao Paulo with 75 students. This movement is on. Cuba, just this 2 years ago, at the end of in November, was an amazing permaculture convergence there, and of course, and hundreds of permies from all over showed up. And then Dave Henson, who's right here, the executive director, and I had the blessing with support of the 11th Hour Project, and I know there's 11th Hour Project folks in the house here, and I want to acknowledge those folks, to go work with Eve Ensler and Dr. Mukwege here in the photo, and Christine DeShriver in Democratic Republic of Congo, on a project where they acquired an 800-acre farm and we're working with them on the community resilience design for creating an organic farm there for women who are victims of mass rape and genocide, to put it just straight up. And it's an amazing process that they've now have been, it's installed, it's up and running, they've harvested thousands of pounds of rice and hundreds of pounds of fish, they're feeding the entire City of Joy project off the farm at this point. It's an incredible, amazing project. Have a look at that. Eve Ensler, what a cast, it's amazing. And at some level, the children are the most valuable on-site resource for the future of all. Kendall Dunnigan, who's hopefully in the house as well, and I were down in Haiti here recently, worked with this group called Sustainable Organic Integrated Livelihoods. And these folks have been collecting human waste in the post-earthquake slums of Port-au-Prince or up in Cap-Haitien in 5-gallon buckets, bringing it to a center, thermophilically composting it, testing it, running it through several cycles, and producing this incredible, beautiful, sweet-smelling, pathogen-free black gold for food production and agroforestry restoration projects on what is a cholera-laden toxic substance. And so stop shitting in water and shit in the carbon cycle and get clear you are what you don't shit. Right? That alone is one of, if you want to reconnect to the carbon cycle, then do that. And so that's been an amazing opportunity to have an organic farm interaction with these other folks who get it. And then there's this whole nexus between the H2O molecule here and the Water Institute. And so I know Kate Lundquist is here, director of the Water Institute as well. And we're just deep into honoring this recognition around the relationship that we got to turn sunlight into sugar, but if there's not water to run the show on the vascular plants, then it's going to be a hard gig. So pairing up the carbon water cycle with the life cycles is key. And I really ultimately look at watersheds as your living lifeboat, and as this idea that ultimately from ridgeline to river mouth, from summit to sea, we have to ultimately develop a rethink of how it is that all human land use occurs within these systems from top to bottom. And so it's the cradle of civilization from a topographic perspective, I think, is defined by watersheds as boundaries that are workable as containers. And there's a guidebook we put out some years, and I don't know if you know where your watershed is tonight or not, but it's worth knowing. Brad Lancaster, such a good friend. I did have the honor of being with Brad Lancaster for a week here just last week with Penny Livingston down at an amazing farm at Tres Estrellas Farm in Tecate. And it's a beautiful organic farm doing amazing work. And I know they have a job announcement for a super eager organic farmer, ready to go, bilingual, who wants to study up on a farm that's 75 years old, the last 30 years in a big way. And if that sounds appetizing to you, then talk to Sarah right here, because I was really impressed with the farm down there. And we were doing a rainwater harvesting consult, and it was really fun to be with Brad. That guy is a character. But the beauty of it is that we don't live in a water scarce area, we live in a storage scarce area. And it's about storage, and that's what carbon and soils and water harvesting is about. And at some level, right, we got to get back to that nuke plant. Because irrigation of the land with seawater desalinated by fusion power is ancient. It's called rain. right? But right now, I'm not doing rainwater harvesting, I'm doing brainwater harvesting, right? Because we're back up here in the headwaters. And so you either perceive it as a problem, and therefore you'll plow it and pipe it and pave it and pollute it, or you see rainwater turned into stormwater as a solution that you'll slow spread and sink using these four R's of conservation hydrology that I made up of receiving, retaining, recharging, retaining, and releasing. And how do we replace the old drain age with a new retain age? The drain age has got to go away. We've got to get into the retain age here. And so slow it, spread it, sink it is really the mantra, and there's a whole number of these books. These are downloadable documents from either Santa Cruz County up just north or Sonoma County, or we've now been working in the Okanagan Basin up in British Columbia at the basin-wide scale on these. They're small solutions, just thinking about your roof as an above-ground well. An inch of rain on 1,000 square feet is 550 gallons of water. If you got a goat shed and some flexible pipe and a tank nearby, really simple, low-tech, gravity-fed system for our chickens. These are documents you can download. It's a project we did at a school in Marin County, Lagunitas there, 30,000-gallon tank for the organic veggie garden there, integrated in the schools, filled off the garden shed or the outdoor eating shed. And then we've been working in a little town of Bodega, not Bodega Bay, but inland from Bodega Bay in Sonoma County. And have a look at this document by Ag Innovations, but it's residential systems. The fire hall now has 40,000 gallons of roof water. And then if you look in the upper two photos, there's a 240,000-gallon underground tank that fills off the roof and has allowed this dairy, this gentleman who raises replacement heifers for the dairy folks, organic, to basically, he's making more money. He's got 100% water off his roof. He's staying out of the creek. He's fenced the creek and done riparian restoration. The flows are back. The coho and steelhead have better spawning habitat. He's making more money because the cows are less sick because the water quality's better, all off of his roof, and he doesn't have the erosion problem from the downspouts that he had before. This is not that complicated, y'all, right? And then I did have this amazing chance as part of the trip to Congo 2 years ago to visit with Dr. Ken Wilson here in a project in Mashiwa, Zimbabwe, in eastern Zimbabwe, and happened to be visiting these farmers who had been attempting to do water harvesting structures, but they didn't get contour, and they weren't putting them online, and they kept blowing out. And as I was standing there, I saw these sticks and the bark they'd just stripped off next to their nascent tomato patch. I was like, well, heck, on-site resources. Grabbed three sticks, bound them together with the bark on site, tied a rock onto the bottom, turned it into an A-frame, which is just a bipedal plumb bob that allows you to find contour, gave them a little workshop. You can see the gal down there in the green. She's like, ah, Mazunga, I'm not up. Did a series of these trainings, and Ken just sent me an email. I just got back and got this email here. And so 18 months later, a little bit less, the teams have now pegged around 200 kilometers of dead level swales in Mashiwa. Not one broke in the heavy rains last year. Things are rocking. That's 100, right? That's 120 miles, all done by communities, and it's all done by the women. They go to the village and they sing a song and they go, Shona, 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 A-frame, Shona, and that. I don't speak Shona, but they're singing in their native language, and there's video, and it's the cutest thing, and then they say, A-frame. And in 18 months, they got 120 miles of these things, and everywhere you go, if you got water, you got crops, you got resiliency, you've got food security, you got a little bit extra money, and you're not moving to Johannesburg and selling yourself on the street. It's incredible how simple this thing is, and we ought to pay a little bit more attention to it in the overdeveloped world. Nothing in nature mimics a road, and I just have to take a whack at, if you want a deranged hydrologic function, then put a bunch of roads across it. So I support all of you in figuring out your roads. These are the two best books on the subject out there. And the Forest Ranch Roads book on the left is actually also been published all in Spanish from the Mendocino Resource Conservation District, $20 book. Look that up. There's no better way to work that out than to figure out your roads. And then at some level, we were thinking about watershed scales. This is a groundwater recharge map that was done for the Sonoma Valley watershed. And I'm really interested in how do we rethink resilient retrofits from ridgeline to river to reef for a reverential rehydration revolution, right? Don't you love alliterations? They're so fun, right? So some of you Californians may have been freaking out because this last year we had three bills, two Senate bills, an Assembly bill on groundwater management get passed, and California finally has joined the other 49 states in the notion of even having groundwater management, which is a completely amazing idea. And I know there's been a lot of grumbling, but I would absolutely support everybody out there to get on one of the groundwater management groups that's going to be formed in your basin to do this deal from ridgeline to river mouth. Think about how you're going to retrofit rainwater to stormwater to recharge for water security for all the right reasons. And if you don't have a seat at that table, you're going to be on a race to the bottom where your watershed's already headed because of the drill, baby, drill mantra of denial around the idea that the government's going to take your property through groundwater management. It really should get on board and be proactive on this one. And it's happening in California right now. And I don't know if Miriam Velada is here, but we, another OEC staff, our staff soil scientist, is running this California Decentralized Water Policy Council. And there's these amazing work groups with lots of folks on them doing black water, gray water, rainwater, stormwater, surface, groundwater, and compost toilets. We're in the middle of a legalizing compost toilets for California program at OEC right now and at a statewide initiative. And it's going to happen. We're going to do this. And just a couple more resources here. There's the California Ag Water Stewardship Initiative that came out of the work of Ag Innovations Network that I was involved with a number of folks. Go on their website and look at all of these amazing case studies about farm ponds and key line and water management, dry farming and such. A couple good publications on that, really informative. And then that group expanded into a bigger network with much more folks at a statewide level. It's now called the California Roundtable on Water and Food Supply. We've put out a series of white papers. Our last one was April 2014 there on From Crisis to Connectivity, Renewed Thinking About Managing California's Water and Food Supply. But before that, From Storage to Retention. And I really ultimately got the group to think of storage as basically moving from storage and think of retention and moving from it as a noun as a verb. Think of retention as a verb. We have to get more verb literate. We're so fixated on charismatic nouns, and then we get stuck with our little charismatic widgets that we don't understand the connectivity of time and space and how they connect together. And the hydrologic cycle is a verb. Props to EcoFarm here. They've had this water stewardship project for a while. Go check their website out. They've got a bunch of videos highlighting a number of programs. Any of the farmers in the house you're up on here? Tomorrow morning, the Market Guard family grass-fed there. Donna will be on a panel on rangelands and such. I saw Albert Strauss earlier at dinner. I don't know if he's in the house here, but lots of folks. Molino Creek. Actually, the first panel I ever got to do in EcoFarm was in 95, and it was with Mark Lipson of Molino Creek, and it was about intentional communities, and they were sort of Papa Bear. Then it was Mark DuPont, who I first met with Rich Merrill in 84, and they were at Sandy Bar Ranch, and they were a couple years old, and we were like three months old as Sewing Circle OAC. And that was a 94 panel. That was my first time to speak at EcoFarm, just so fun. So I appreciate the Molino Creek folks is where I'm headed with that recognition as well. Check out Pacific Institute, right? Those dry farm tomatoes are so good. Are you kidding me? Check out Pacific Institute. They've got amazing amounts of really smart information on supporting agricultural innovations around water in a good way that's benefiting everybody involved. But at some point, you're going to have to sink your teeth into this, because if you're going to study hydromodification, then you've got to basically apprentice yourself to Castor canadensis, the mighty beaver. And they're nature's aquatic engineers, the lumberman, the architect, the engineer, the beaver, right? And there were estimates of 600 million beavers in North America at the time, and the whole hats and things and French moving across and the mountain men and the sea captains and the Russian-American fur company just completely nuked them. And if you want to talk about messing up a hydrologic system, pull out the best hydroengineer evolutions ever designed. So we've got a campaign, and we're super clear not all dams nor dam makers are created equally. We want to... I'd love to see a Hoover dam scale set of dams. I just want it to be 1,000 5-foot dams instead of 1,000-foot dam. Right? It's about decentralized, distributed relationship to stack functions. And folks in Idaho got this. In 1948, they parachuted beaver into the wilderness because they knew beaver were beneficial. California wouldn't be outdone. So in 1950, they parachuted beaver into the wilderness because, as it says, beaver dams in the mountains save water for fish, wildlife, and agriculture. So we should get back on board with this. Let's get on the cutting edge of a 70-year-old idea here, right? And to give New Mexico a little bit of props over there next Arizona in Baja, Arizona, Baja, New Mexico. These folks have been working on beaver as a climate change adaptation tool, and states all over the West are doing this at a statewide level, seeing beaver as one tool in the toolbox for resiliency within the fluvial system of your state, and we should get on board with this. And so talk to Kate Lundquist here, because we currently have a statewide campaign in California, and we think we ought to change the flag in California. Right? Grizzly's extinct. Unfortunately, we'll bring it back at some point. Wolf just showed up. But until then, let's bring back beaver to California to do the work they do. So, three slides here from our illustrious, really good friend and colleague, OAC colleague there, Renata Brillinger. I'm not sure if Renata made it yet tonight. Is she here? With CalCAN, California Climate and Ag Network. And you'll see a whole bunch of our colleagues there. But Renata just whipped up two slides for me because I was asking her what's happening with CalCAN on the subject. And if you're not familiar with CalCAN, then by all means have a look at their website. But ultimately trying to bring forward a voice for sustainable agricultural policy here about the climate benefits of farmland protection, on-farm renewable energy, cap and trade question. Some might not want it if the ranch is good to go anyway. Healthy soils for climate protection, farm bill conservation programs, and then the water energy efficiency programs. But what's most interesting here that's most current politically in California is Governor Brown getting reelected here again. And the idea that he just said this in his inaugural address that we must manage farms and rangelands so they can store carbon. Right, bring it on. And in his 2015-16 budget, although it's not enough money apparently, but something, he's got a statement in there, healthy soils. As the leading agricultural state in the nation, it is important for California's soils to be sustainable and resilient to climate change. In the upcoming year, the administration will work on new initiatives to increase carbon in soil and establish long-term goals for carbon levels in all California's agricultural soils. So you all, hold him to it. Hold him to it. Get organized. Get your lobbyists on this. Show up in Sacramento. We need to do this. Let's keep his fight, his feet to the carbon fire on that one and do that. And so at some point, you're going to have to go to the mic and speak truth to power and get political in our democracy here. That's Total Sam in there, who was actually did win an EcoFarm award at the talent show one year as well after speaking to the Board of Supervisors. But at some point, you're going to have to get political and reconnect with this idea, that this notion of conservation hydrology. What is it to have a regenerative, rehydrative, receiving, recharging, retaining, releasing, reverential, revolutionary retrofit? What is that going to look like from ridgeline to river mouth? All of us think about it on ag soils, rangeland soils, forest soils, rural, suburban, and urban systems from top to bottom. We can do this, and the no regrets policy says that in this planning is best done in advanced idea, what we get out of it is regenerative hedonism. Because the pleasure in the pursuit and the benefit of the system will get us to the point where it's going to be more fun, and our party's going to be better than theirs. And so you get to pick and choose. If you want to go fast, go alone. But if you want to go far, go together. And I think this African proverb is quite astute to this community that's been going together for 35 years and the next 35 and counting. And so I thank you for your time, and I let you off the hook.
Ought to give us all something to cogitate and resuscitate on. So we thank Brock, Gary, Bill McKibben, and all of you for participating tonight. I want to let you know that right now in Nautilus there is a reception with refreshments, a chance to mingle and to see the historical exhibit of Ecological Farming Association art. So thank you all, and we'll see you tomorrow.